The next item of business is a debate on motion number 2418 in the name of Shirley-Ann Somerville on the Scottish Government's consultation on a strategy for science, technology, engineering and mathematics education and training. Would those members who wish to speak in the debate please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Shirley-Ann Somerville to speak to and move the motion. Around 12 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you for the promotion, Presiding Officer. On Tuesday this week, I had the great privilege of spending time with the children and teachers at Cardinbridge Primary School in Dunfries. There I saw P6 and 7 pupils enjoying an interesting and lively lesson making kaleidoscopes, learning along the way about the principles of light, combining science, technology and mathematics into one practical, lively and very interesting lesson. I heard how their close partnership with a local manufacturer developed over a number of years is helping the children at the school to develop an appreciation of the skills needed in a workplace. And I was at that primary school to launch the government's consultation on a STEM education and training strategy for Scotland. What I saw there really does encapsulate the aims of the strategy perfectly. Excellence, a deep attention to learning and teaching quality. Equity, ensuring a quality experience for all, regardless of gender or circumstances. Inspiration, inspiring and enthusing people to study STEM. And connection, the school making the most of the links with local employers to bring the learning to life and the employer securing their talent pipeline. Put simply, all children and young people need to have this kind of experience during their school age. And on this, and only this, I agree with the Labour and Conservative amendments today when they say that urgent action is needed and is required to develop STEM skills, knowledge and capability. They will be assured then that such action is indeed well underway. Because the consultation I launched on Tuesday sets out an ambitious and comprehensive plan, the first ever single plan coordinating all our activity across government for developing Scotland's STEM talent and capability. And I in particular want to thank Professor Sheila Rowan, Scotland's Chief Scientific Advisor, for helping me to develop this strategy and for agreeing to help the government forge strong links with the science community as we take that forward. Presiding Officer, science, technology, engineering and mathematics are the cornerstones of modern life and in a modern competitive economy. We all need to be STEM literate to succeed at work, particularly the growing range of careers and occupations dependent on the specialist STEM skills. And as I saw at Cardinbridge on Tuesday, STEM ignites our curiosity about the world around us. All our children and young people need to develop STEM skills and confidence throughout their education, as do adults too. And that's why we are already taking action. Developing the young workforce is driving action nationally, regionally and locally to ensure that children and young people gain the STEM capability they will need in the workplace. We've also got the most comprehensive package of support for science engagement in the UK through our science centres and festivals. We're taking action to support science provision all the way through primary school, including a 3-year, £1 million partnership with the Wood Foundation, which from this month will see primary science leaders in place in 5 initial participating local authorities, and an investment this year of £855,000 to upskill primary and secondary teachers and technicians. Certainly.
Very grateful to the Minister. Yesterday, the Cabinet Secretary outlined the very fair point to a science conference close to here, that the number of students, pupils sitting science subjects at higher level, math subjects and computer subjects, was falling. Is the strategy going to deal with exactly that point? And does she have an explanation for Parliament this afternoon as to why those numbers are going the wrong direction?
Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Well, in part, the numbers are going down because there was a decrease in the number of students who were in that year in school. There has been an increase in certain aspects, such as human biology and computing science. But Tavish Tukot does raise a very important point, that we do need to enthuse more people to take part in all these subjects within their schools. So we have recognised that there was a dip last year, although I would point out over the longer term that the numbers are pointing in the right direction. Now, I know that the opposition do like to pluck statistics out, particularly if there's a bad year to point out, But as I said, the trends overall are positive. Since 2007, there's been a 7% increase indeed in passes at higher in STEM subjects. And we want to keep that long-term trend on track and enable more young people to study for STEM-related qualifications and crucially to achieve those qualifications. One area which we can also agree needs to be addressed is the gender imbalance in STEM. And on this too, we are making progress with the number of girls both taking and passing hires in key STEM subjects increasing since 2007. Now, there are other challenges and our strategy sets out how we will tackle these.
Alison Johnson.
I welcome the strategy's intent on gender segregation, but can the Minister commit to pushing this right up the agenda? The Minister and I attended the Equate Scotland reception recently and heard from, you know, many women enjoying fabulous careers, and I think it's really important that we make sure both, you know, that all our young people have the opportunity to be involved. And on the young people front, can the Minister commit to ensuring that all our young people have the chance to attend the fabulous science festivals and so on that take place in Scotland?
Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Alison Johnson raises two very important points. On the aspect of girls and young women taking up STEM subjects, I had the opportunity to visit City of Glasgow College recently and met some women who were taking part in a women-only first-year engineering course, which was very important to them. And I think that will be a very interesting point to tease out during the consultation to get further evidence back about that, because it clearly made a difference to those women, and we need to see how we can extend and incorporate that if it helps the women that are there. And on the science festivals and centres which we have, it's already within the strategy that we need to make sure that extends to every young person within Scotland, regardless of where they are. And I'm particularly keen to seek advice and suggestions on how we target rural areas, those in deprived communities, and young women to ensure that they're all getting the maximum benefit they can from that. So I'm happy to take those points on board. Now, we do, within the strategy, need to improve the levels of STEM enthusiasm and skills and knowledge to raise attainment and aspirations in learning, life and work. But we also need to encourage and promote the uptake of more specialist STEM skills required to gain employment in the growing STEM sectors in our economy. And as I mentioned, there are four priority themes of excellence, equity and inspiration and connection within the strategy. Within the theme of excellence, we'll take action to improve the numbers of STEM teachers in secondary schools. We'll build on the success of last year's marketing campaign to attract more people with STEM undergraduate degrees into teaching. And new and innovative routes into STEM teaching will be in place from next academic year onwards. We'll also help teachers and educators build their own STEM capability and confidence, particularly in primary schools. Certainly.
Tetman, Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was wondering if the Minister could spell out in more detail what these alternative routes might be and what they will mean in terms of qualification and time spent in training. And will there be a guarantee that the full teaching qualifications will be required before people teach in a classroom?
Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Well, I'm not going to go into detail on that in this particular debate, because the consultation and the delivery of that will come very, very soon within a number of responses that we've had in. But it is very important that we do secure the qualified nature of people within our schools, but encourage people to get into that rather than changing the basis of teachers within our schools. So the qualifications are still very important within that. Now, we will also deliver on making maths count recommendations for improving young people's confidence and fluency in mathematics, and we'll also continue to encourage colleges and universities to prioritise STEM courses through the outcome agreement process. On the theme of equity, we will take action to address gender bias in young people's career options, including by expanding our successful collaboration with the Institute of Physics Improving Gender Balance project. We'll always seek ways to ensure gender imbalance in college and university STEM courses are tackled, and also within modern apprenticeship routes through the Equality Action Plan. On the theme of inspiration, as I've mentioned to Alison Johnson, we're very keen to support the science centres and festival to engage all people of all ages into STEM and direct this at hard-to-reach individuals, groups and communities in deprived, rural and remote areas. The Making Maths Count group said earlier this year that the government needed to do more to help people understand the relevance of mathematics to daily life and work, and we'll do this by finding new ways to promote the value and benefit of broader STEM learning as well. On the theme of connection, we'll embed STEM careers and awareness within STEM teaching and learning at school and help practitioners to do this. We'll encourage schools to use the labour market information and their links with employers to design and deliver a relevant STEM curriculum for their children and for young people. We'll promote new pathways into STEM careers, including the continued expansion of pathways that can begin at school, for example, through foundation apprenticeships. Now, actions which cut across all of these themes include the very important manifesto commitment we had to ensure that a Scottish STEM Ambassador programme is developed to bring inspiration to young people. Helping more schools to develop high-quality, embedded partnerships with local employers and individuals, including in the public and third sector, like I saw at Cardigan Bridge. We'll also encourage peer-to-peer mentoring and support for STEM. We'll explore hub arrangements to achieve deeper connections and collaborations between education and employers. And learning from international best practice on this, including the Finnish LUMA centres in Finland, mentioned in the recent STEIMEC report. Presiding Officer, this is very much just the start. We are open to new thinking, creative solutions and bold ideas. I'm particularly keen during this consultation process to hear from children and young people, as well as parents and carers. We also want to hear from education practitioners, employers and the STEM community. I'm pleased that many in the sector have commended our move to consult, including Professor Yellowlees, the convener of the RSE's Learn Societies Group on STEM Education. It's disappointing, therefore, today that the opposition parties have united in the main to retread largely inaccurate claims. We all agree that there is more to do, but consulting on this strategy shows our willingness and our absolute commitment to address all of these, and indeed to listen to others' ideas. And if the opposition parties have them, then I would welcome hearing them. And while we're there, while we're waiting for those to happen, I'll get on with the Chief Scientific Advisor to engage with the larger sector and with community to see how we can develop a STEM strategy which will enable us to meet the demands and challenges of our economy and build on the society that we want to see now and in the future. And I move the motion in my name.
I now call on Liz Smith to speak to and move Amendment 2418.1. 8 minutes, please, Ms. Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm just interested in the fact that the Minister has made a comment that this is just a beginning and that, you know, we're in a situation where she wants to hear what the suggestions are from the opposition parties. I look back at this last decade of parliamentary debates on STEM and I was very struck not only by the frequency of them but also by the consistency of the propositions, I don't agree with them all, but the propositions that were made by individual parties and broadly agreed in some cases. And I have to say this afternoon that's going to be no different because I think there is a very strong case to be made this afternoon that the opposition parties have actually been making, I think, very sensible suggestions for quite a long period of time. And we seem to be standing still to some extent because there is no disagreement, let me be clear, there's no disagreement about what the Scottish Government's motion is saying. But it leaves out something that is very, very significant. If you consider what was said in the introduction to the SEAG report of 2012, when the Scottish Government had quite rightly, in my opinion, identified that energy and life sciences were two key priorities in Scotland, what is it that has held us back? Now, some of the statistics, and we all use statistics to our own advantage, of course we do, but the overall set of statistics on STEM, Minister, are really not good. Can I just remind the Chamber of what Tim Peake said when he came back from that wonderful space mission, when he spoke to thousands of youngsters, and he said, never let anybody tell you that you can't do something. And I think it was a message to all of us that there are lots of budding scientists out there, but there is something that is holding them back. And that's what we have to address in this debate. And may I suggest that in Scotland, I think a large part of that problem relates to teacher shortages in our school. Not general shortages, but specific shortages. Something that I think was hinted at by the Cabinet Secretary when he spoke to the Royal Society of Chemistry yesterday. And I'm sure the opposition parties this afternoon will use their statistics for the work that they have done over quite a long period of time, but can I just summarise it briefly? And this is over a decade that we have 410 fewer maths teachers, we have 187 fewer computer teachers, we have 105 fewer chemistry teachers, and we also have obviously some concerns that there will be decreases in other subjects, not least because there are some worrying downturns, as Tavish Scott has rightly referred to, when it comes to higher and advanced higher entries. Yes, it's true that some cohorts of pupils have declined in number, but that over 10-year period is still a very worrying downturn. 10 out of 32 local authorities have had trouble recruiting a computing teacher. 12% of schools do not have a computing science teacher at all. Computing at School Scotland is not the only organisation to be critical about this. The STEMEC report notes a failure to meet the targets. Yes, of course.
Shirley Ann Somerville.
Grateful for Les Smith for taking the intervention. Will she be pleased to welcome the figures from last year, which show that student intake number for chemistry is up, student intake number for physics is up, for maths it's up, and for computing it's up. So while there are issues that we do need to take on board, we have been increasing the number of student figures fifth year in a row, and we are taking action on it year by year.
Liz Smith.
I thank the Minister for that. I have the statistics right in front of me, but there are general statistics on top of that that produce a trend that is not particularly encouraging. And if you put that together with, the problem with the recruitment of teachers, then there is a serious issue. And that's what we're driving at this afternoon. And particularly, if I may say so, there was a very good call made from the Royal Society of Chemistry, exactly the same event that we were all at yesterday. 2 years ago, they made that specific claim about having dedicated science teachers in primary schools. Personally, I think that's one of the best suggestions that we can put forward, because I think it is at the very age where we want to ensure that they are most inspired by...
John Swinney.
Grateful to Liz Smith, because I think she knows that the seriousness with which I'm intent on addressing this issue. But Liz Smith also has to complete some of her arguments. Liz Smith comes to Chamber frequently and demands the government prioritises literacy and numeracy. And in the curriculum guidance that I issued in August, that is precisely what I have done. And now we've got to have dedicated primary school teachers specialising in science. And I just simply say to Liz Smith that there needs to be a rounded consistency in the arguments that she puts forward, because there is a logical inconsistency in demanding that we prioritise literacy and numeracy and then saying, but you've also got to do this thing as well. And it's a frequent point I make to the Conservatives, who are not shy about coming forward with this argument, but then proliferate the demands that they put on us of issues that need to be concentrated on in the curriculum.
I can allow you some extra time, Ms Smith.
Thank you. But Cabinet Secretary, it's not an either-or situation. And the response that you gave to the Royal Society of Chemistry when you were asked that very question by a member of the audience yesterday about can you put the same priority on literacy and numeracy as you can in science, you were equivocal in your comments. And this is something that we need to home in. Carry on.
We've not got too much time, Mr Swinney.
I'll come back to address some issues later, but I wasn't equivocal at all. I made it quite clear I was giving greater priority to literacy, numeracy and health and wellbeing, and I couldn't do it to everything. So if there was anything equivocal about my answer, I hope I've said it more bluntly in Parliament today. But I simply point out the contradiction in the argument that Liz Smith is making to me, that we need to strengthen literacy and numeracy, but also science as well. And the broad general education has got to cover all these issues, but there has to be priority given to other factors.
Liz Smith.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm not disagreeing with you about the literacy and the numeracy aspect, but in terms of the commitment that you put out in 2012 about the importance of the life sciences and the STEM subjects for the national economy, never mind for education, that's not a contradiction. That's all part of what is good for education in Scotland just now. Anyway, can I progress on some other aspects of what I want to say? Because this is an important point. I don't actually mind staying on this point, because I have a huge number of emails that have come in since that event yesterday when we made the commitment again about primary school science teaching. And I think it is a fundamental core of the issue that we're having to address just now. Now, I think, obviously, in terms of some of the colleges and universities, I think they've done a lot of tremendously good work. The Minister is absolutely correct when she says that there is some good work happening there. But nonetheless, this is something that we need to expand upon. And if it's about ensuring that there is a wider aspect, and I think Daniel Johnson asked you a little while ago about the pathways into that profession. I think we do need to have some answers about that. I think it's vitally important that we know what the intention is, because I think it's not a contradiction to ensure that you can have that highly professional teaching commitment at the same time as allowing other people who have an expertise and an enthusiasm to come and do some science teaching. So if the government is considering that, I'm pleased, but let's please have some detail about that, because I think it's very important. Now, just in my final few seconds, can I just sum up from the fact that we have been here before. We've been here actually for a very long period of time. I've been very assiduous in going through a lot of the debates that we've had in this very chamber, and indeed some of the other debates that we've had in learned societies and royal societies, and we're standing still. We're not moving forward. If there's anything that I want to ask the Scottish Government to do this afternoon in conjunction with the other opposition parties, please put some priority on the teaching of science. I move the motion in my name. Sorry, the amendment in my name.
That's the amendment moved, to clarify for the official report. I now call Ian Gray to speak to and move amendment to amendment 2418.1.1. 7 minutes, please, Mr. Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I rise to move the amendment in my name, and indeed to welcome the government's strategy for education and training in STEM subjects. It would be churlish not to at least welcome the fact that there is a strategy before us, and that has to be a good thing. But we can't ignore the fact, referred to by Liz Smith, that we can't ignore the fact that it has been such a long time coming, and that it is not, of course, actually here yet, since this week's document is a consultation on the strategy, which we're told is due in March next year. And that is not to say that much work has not been done on the issue in the intervening years, most notably by the STEMEC committee, who published their own report a few weeks ago. Now, yesterday at the Science in the Parliament event, the Cabinet Secretary in his speech said that he hoped the members of STEMEC would recognise that the themes of their report are reflected in the government document. And I think that the members of that committee will indeed be able to recognise and be pleased to see their themes reflected in the government document. But I fear that they will be disappointed that it fails to reflect the clear practical recommendations which they have also made. In truth, it replaces too many of those recommendations with rather pious hopes. Take the example, again, of the shortage of teachers in STEM. Now, teacher education institutions, I freely admit, have increased their places for STEM teachers. But we know that they struggle to fill all of those places, particularly in some subjects such as physics and computer science. STEMEC makes suggestions to address this. The use of incentives, for example, which has been deployed elsewhere in the UK, but it is a suggestion the government has always resisted. The government strategy itself says that it will improve the pipeline of STEM teachers into secondary schools, but it does not tell us how it will do that, with its only suggestion sounding rather like the suggestion of a dilution of professional standards. Perhaps it is not that, but the Minister's explanation today didn't leave us any the wiser. Or what about something like the Scottish Schools Education Research Centre, which STEMEC devote a whole section to. And that's an institution which has been driving innovation in science teaching since my days as a science teacher. It's well known, well used, and well trusted by the profession. STEMEC recommend funding the expansion of that institution with its proven track record, but the government strategy ignores CERC altogether. Or science in primary schools, as Smith spoke about. STEMEC makes clear proposals, raising the requirement for STEM qualification for new entrants in the primary teaching profession, specific support in STEM for new primary teachers in their first years in the profession. The government document acknowledges that early years in primary school are crucial for STEM, but it has no new plan, no new action and no new funding to reflect the importance of it. Indeed, if there is one theme of the STEM 8 report which the government document does not reflect, it is inaction, that these recommendations were already made in the previous report by the SIA group in 2012, and largely in the Excellence in Science Teaching report in 2011. They were even presaged, most of them, in 2003 in the Science Advisory Committee's report, Why Science Education Matters. Many over the years have been made by bodies like the Royal Society of Edinburgh too. The report itself says, plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose. Nothing has changed. 13 years on, and the government is still consulting on what to do instead of getting on with doing what everyone is telling them they must. Sure.
Sandra White. The member for taking intervention. We're looking at innovative ways, the motion says, and I think some of the amendments say also. Do you not agree that places like the Glasgow Science Centre, which is actually married to the curriculum of excellence that brings science into primary schools, is a good way of embracing, an innovative way of embracing young primary school kids into actually enjoying and learning about science as well? Ian Gray.
Well, I absolutely do. But what Stemmett would say to you is that the degree of confidence that primary teachers have to build on that kind of engagement is critical to improving science teaching in our primary schools. It's not an either-or, it's about building on something which the Stemmett report says should be supported. Presiding Officer, if there's one thing which characterises science, it is its empiricism. Any valid theory must be testable by reference to the real world real-world observations. So to test my hypothesis that the government has not done enough on STEM, we should look at the data. And the data tells us we've lost 800 teachers in STEM subjects over the last 10 years. Lab assistants in schools are down by half since 2007. Technicians down by a quarter. Average annual spend on science in primary schools per pupil £1.62 compared to £2.89. In England, £7.33 in a secondary school compared to over £10 in England. Not my figures, the Royal Society of Edinburgh's figures. And for years, we have told ministers that STEM subjects are being squeezed in the curriculum. And now we see that impact in hires. Pupils last year sitting over 4,000 fewer STEM hires. That's not a blip, Minister. That is a trend which has been evident in S4 for some years, now coming through into S5 and into F6. You know, science can never ignore the evidence. And that is why it's not enough to welcome the strategy or to consult seriously without acknowledging the decline in outcomes and the failure over years to deliver on recommendations from bodies like STEMEC. That is why we've tabled the amendment that we have. Now, Presiding Officer, when Mr. Swinney spoke to the Science and Parliament conference yesterday, I have to give him credit. He acknowledged, of his own accord, the fall in STEM teachers and the decline in STEM hires in the last year. So if these statistics are inaccurate, Minister, then the inaccuracy is shared by the Cabinet Secretary. That was commendable honesty on his part. And for that reason, I see no reason why the government shouldn't accept the amendments before them today. But though the Cabinet Secretary may have accepted yesterday the challenges of STEM education, the strategy doesn't rise to meet them. It is largely more of the same. So unless it returns next year with clear, practical and funded solutions like those recommended by STEMEC, then we risk a slow decline in STEM education over the next 10 years, as we've seen in the past 10.
We now move to the open session speeches of no more than 5 minutes, please. And can I remind all members that they should speak through the chair and not directly to each other during debates. And I call on Claire Adamson to be followed by Ross Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I declare an interest as a board member of the Scottish Schools Education Research Centre, SSERC, highly commended by Ian Gray in his submission today. Presiding Officer, there's been a murder, a pure dead bad murder, and I think I've got some attention. And I think that's exactly what the science departments and faculties and primary schools across Scotland who have intrigued, inspired and entertained pupils by hosting CSI events in their curriculum. Such as in my own area in 2003, St Aidan's Primary, had a forensic specialist visit the school with the pupils to crack a case, in this case not a murder, but a chocolate heist from the staff room. And during a 6-week long project, the children learned how to examine fingerprints, hair samples, use digital microscopes, work field signs. They had worked on hair fibre and fibre analysis, fingerprinting and dental forensics, all to solve the crime of who had stolen the chocolates from the staff room. And the head teacher says that this was an amazing experience for the young people. The children really enjoyed it. It was part of their computer explorers classes at that time. And they involved not just learning about science, but learning about ICT and problem skills and working in a team and all those great experiences that we want for all our children in Scotland. And I appreciate that there is a lack of confidence in some primary schools about tackling such issues and bringing such of these experiences to young people. And I'd like to commend the SSERC again in their broadcast seminars into schools, something they call a cook-along, where they have an expert delivering a lesson where the necessary equipment for the lesson is provided to the primary school, and the teacher does this along with the expert, allowing the pupils to get the advantage of an expert in the field and to build the confidence in the teacher in actually delivering science. But I do believe that one of the important things about the strategy will be inspiration. It's the key to encouraging, motivating and inspiring our young people. And a long time, long, long time ago, and since we may well touch on multiverse theory this afternoon, perhaps even in a galaxy far, far away, my own inspiration came from watching old BBC broadcasts of David Attenborough and Horizon and the occasional OU broadcast late at night on the television, and from reading science fiction. My hero, Richard Feynman, I learned about from his autobiography, Surely You're Joking, Mr. Feynman, The Adventures of a Curious Character. And it did make me curious about physics, about code breaking, which led to my career in IT, and curiosity itself. For the young people today, they can view every one of Mr. Feynman's lectures online. I remember the first time I heard his voice at the time of the Challenger disaster, something that hitherto had just been in my imagination as a young woman. And I think it's the inspiring people like him who we have to reach our young people today. So how do we inspire in this sort of world overloaded with information and the World Wide Web? How do we inspire our young people? Well, just this weekend, I had the pleasure of hosting in the Parliament a CERN TED Talk. This was delivered from CERN, who of course themselves are engaged in educational programmes, which many Scottish schools have had the ability to take part in over the years. And the TED Talk covered areas of oceanography, drone technology, imagine we could really play Quidditch, dark matter, DNA editing, medical testing, biotechnology and neurons, literacy using subtitling of Bollywood movies, and blockchains and artificial intelligence. It was quite an afternoon. I was delighted to be joined by some of my colleagues from the Chamber, including Jenny Gilruth, who brought along her sister, who's a physics teacher, and I'm sure was very inspired by the event. But why this is so important? Well, there were two particular TED Talks I want to bring to the Chamber's attention. Kate Stafford did one on oceanography, which was amazing. But we also had one on DIY science. Now, this was a scientist who was involved in the oil disaster in the US and founded a not-for-profit organization called Public Lab, which engages with community and helps design do-it-yourself research tools for grassroots science. So this is real communities getting a benefit of using scientists who know a lot about their area to come into their communities and do it. But the most important one, I think, is Sheila Rowan on gravity waves. And why is this important? What more to inspire our young people than our very own homegrown experts in the area, the Director of the Institute of Gravitational Research at Glasgow. We should be using these examples to inspire our young women and STEM teaching in Scotland.
I was loath to stop you giving that explanation. I don't know what blockchains are, but no doubt somebody in the debate will tell me. Ross Thompson, to be followed by Jenny Gilruth.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to declare an interest as a member of Aberdeen City Council. I'm sure that all members across this chamber recognise the excellent reputation that Scotland has across the globe as a true leader in STEM subjects. Since the dawn of the Scottish Enlightenment, Scotland has demonstrated its dynamic entrepreneurial spirit. When the Enlightenment met the Industrial Revolution, our combination of sheer intellectual endeavour and commercial might shaped a new world, a new economic outlook. Scotland cemented herself as the home of ideas. From the discovery of antibiotics and tropical medicine to the invention of the steam engine and the television, it is from history that we recognise these great achievements in science. We must aim to channel this historic success into the promotion of important STEM education and training for future generations to come. Given our proud heritage, it is increasingly alarming that when it comes to the government's record on STEM education and training, we have a legacy that is less than satisfactory. A significant failure of this government is that all age cohorts and SCQF levels, the uptake of and attainment in STEM subjects by girls and women, is significantly lagging behind that of their male counterparts. Despite boys and girls having an equal interest in science and technology at a young age, this engagement in STEM declines as they progress through the education system. And as such, it is boys who are more likely to proceed with subjects such as physics, chemistry, engineering and computing. Keir Bloomer, who is one of the architects of the Curriculum for Excellence, has warned that we need to do much more to improve basic skills. At secondary school, girls represent only 7% of entries for higher technological studies and 20% of entries for higher computing. Additionally, between 2011 and 16, the number of female students taking higher biology fell by an astounding 21%. From statistics such as these, it's obvious that not enough is being done by the government to encourage girls to take up these vitally important subjects, subjects which are increasingly becoming more attractive and sought after in a technologically advancing economy. To quote Equate Scotland, the possibilities in the industry are limitless, but for women, the opportunities are limited. It is hard to believe, however, that such damning figures are unrelated to the... Yeah, I'll give way to
Stuart MacDonald.
Thanks very much.
I beg your pardon, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank Ross Thompson for taking the intervention. Just on his latter point there regarding opportunities, does Ross Thompson, is he seriously saying to this chamber that there have always been opportunities in science, technology, engineering and mathematical subjects and workplaces? Is he saying that that's always been the case over the generations?
Ross Thompson.
There are opportunities and we need to do more. And I think if you come along to the Equate Scotland reception, I know there's going to be things in Parliament this week that we should be working together to ensure that we do attract more women and girls, not just into STEM, but into apprenticeships. And there's a whole culture change and image change which this government and this Parliament needs to help to address. Now, it's hard to believe, however, that such damning figures are unrelated to the critical shortage of qualified teachers in schools across Scotland. And therefore, before girls and women can overcome these limited opportunities, the Scottish Government must effectively address the challenge we face in recruiting teachers. Now, in my region of the northeast of Scotland, we are still facing a major teacher recruitment crisis, where there is a growing gap in secondary teachers of STEM subjects. Now, Aberdeen City Council in particular have been very open about the problems it has faced in recruiting and retaining teachers, despite a range of initiatives, including cash incentives and offers of low-cost accommodation. Now, just last year, we did ask for assistance in the shape of a waiting allowance to take into account the high cost of living and for a review of the funding settlement for local authorities. However, so far, this has been ignored, and therefore the chronic shortage of teachers means that we're now in danger of some schools having to close their doors altogether. We urgently need to look at the roots of this complex problem. With seven councils covering a geographical area from Shetland to Oban coming together to say the same thing, it becomes a national issue that transcends party politics and one which we must work together to address. The North East is desperately in need of the government to come forward in order to help provide meaningful support to help address these problems, which are crippling our schools and doing our young people a disservice. Deputy Presiding Officer, for Scotland to flourish and to continue to lead the world in STEM, we need qualified teachers in our classrooms, which is why I will be supporting the amendment in the name of Liz Smith, and I would urge members across this chamber to do the very same.
Thank you very much, Mr. Thompson. Jenny Gilruth, to be followed by Mark Griffin. Ms. Gilruth, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's motion commends the government's STEM education and training strategy to Parliament. And it's clear that there is a link between the government's aspirations to close the attainment gap and to upskill the next generation in these subject areas. Science, technologies, engineering, maths, especially for Scotland's girls. Yesterday, we saw Donald Trump become president-elect of the most powerful economy in the world. In Hillary Clinton's concession speech, she commented, "To all the little girls who are watching this, never doubt that you are valuable and powerful and deserving of every chance and opportunity in the world to pursue and achieve your own dreams." Presiding Officer, I note the amendment in the name of the Labour Party, which comments on the decrease of in pupils taking STEM subjects. Nonetheless, since 2007, the total number of pupils has nearly decreased by 30,000 in total across Scotland's high schools. So there is an overall trend in terms of our pupil population declining. And £88 million of Scottish Government funding is, however, being spent this year alone to support the Government's commitment to maintain teacher numbers and redress this balance. For too long, however, subject choice in our secondary schools has been gendered. A survey recently conducted by Equate Scotland found that over 70% of girls, women, teachers and employers want regular talks in Scottish schools promoting STEM subjects to girls. I'm delighted that Equate Scotland's report has been backed by the First Minister. The First Minister has put on record her commitment to work in partnership to address the underrepresentation of women in STEM courses and careers, like physics. Indeed, my younger sister, who Claire Adamson has thankfully already mentioned today, and who rejoices every time I mention her in a parliamentary speech, was the only girl in her higher and advanced higher physics class at school. And despite the gender segregation she experienced at school, she is now a physics teacher in the First Minister's constituency. The STEM consultation commits the government to work with schools and employers to prevent bias on career choice and encourage more diverse subject choices in order to meet the participation improvement targets. And between 2007 and 2016, the number of entries by girls to the main science higher qualifications, including computing, increased by 3%. The number of passes for girls in higher chemistry and physics is up 8% and 10% respectively. And passes by girls in biology are down 16.9%. However, this is in the context of a 62% increase in passes in human biology for girls. And from a personal perspective, as a former secondary teacher, I would say that the delivery of human biology is quite differential across the country. So schools perhaps need to look at their courses and look at the uptake in terms of what they deliver, because I know that a lot of girls quite often prefer to specialise in human biology as opposed to biology itself. So, Presiding Officer, when I was at school, I studied chemistry and physics at standard grade. And chemistry will forever be to me a world of moles and atoms, somewhere where I could just see no logic. But physics, I loved. I loved physics because I had a great teacher, Mr. Pierce. Mr. Pierce was a great teacher because he took time to explain things. We measured velocity in class, and I pinched my little sister's Duplo truck and watched it roll down a plank onto our wooden science benches. We measured the distance, the time, the speed. And I remember using the same equation in maths and suddenly understanding the links between physics and maths, like a light bulb in my head. Presiding Officer, you will know that this government is committed to closing the attainment gap between Scotland's poorest and richest pupils. To do that, we need to raise ambition in the next generation, and increasing uptake, therefore, in these subjects will be vital. I recently visited the new Leavenmouth campus of Fife College, which has been supported by over £25 million of Scottish Government funding. Fife College's STEM strategy is focused on reducing inequalities, on reducing low-income households, and on raising educational attainment whilst reducing educational inequality. And I spoke with one of the tutors at the college about the gender makeup of his engineering classes. And he told me that when the college do get the girls in the front door, they are not just good, they are brilliant. He agreed with me that the issue wasn't the quality of female students who did present for engineering courses. Rather, it was about building their confidence in school to believe and realise their capabilities in engineering. Traditional, stereotypical notions of what constitutes an engineer persist. The STEM consultation framework, however, explicitly seeks to take action to reduce equity gaps, particularly in relation to deprivation and to gender. The Scottish Government's STEM strategy is ambitious for Scotland's future, and it seeks to redress that gender imbalance in subject choice and to build confidence in the next generation that STEM subjects are those that everyone can enjoy, regardless of gender. Presiding Officer, yesterday many of us in this chamber were devastated that Hillary Clinton did not manage to smash one of the largest glass ceilings in elected politics. But this government's STEM strategy sets out a route map for Scotland's girls to become future lead learners themselves in science, engineering, technology and maths. That should be something that everyone in this chamber should support. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gilruth. Mark Griffin, to be followed by Stuart Stevenson. Mr. Griffin, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've heard a lot about the provision of STEM education in schools this afternoon, but for me, a key point is the expectation that by 2030, over 7 million jobs in the UK will depend on science skills. Those science roles are exactly what we need. High quality, high skilled and highly paid jobs, which other emerging economies will struggle to compete with us for. And by 2030, the 4- and 5-year-olds who started primary school this summer will be in work or possibly at university. And if current spending levels continue, the same pupils with the same academic ability, the same aptitude for science, and England will have enjoyed over 10 years of state education with 80% more in primary school and 27% more in secondary school being spent on science equipment. And that's according to a report published by Learned Societies Group. There's also the issue around science technicians and support staff. And last year, I had submitted an FOI request to all 32 local authorities on science technician numbers. There had been an overall drop in the number of science technicians, with one authority cutting technician staff by over 50%. Now, those are the staff that maintain or repair what practical science equipment our schools actually have. They're the people who are setting up the science labs and the complex experiments that teaching staff just don't have the time for, and it's hard to see those numbers increase as budget cuts to local authorities continue to bite. I think if the Scottish Government wants to talk about inspiration as one of the 4 key priorities for action, I would suggest that the best way to inspire young people to pursue a career in STEM is through the teaching of practical science. And the example the Minister gave of the school she visited and the work that the pupils were doing is a perfect example. But to do that, we have to address the imbalance between what's spent on equipment, practical science equipment and staff in the rest of the UK compared to Scotland. And I think it would also go some way to addressing another of the government's key priority action areas on inequality. That same report from the Learned Societies Group also reported that 98% of Scottish schools are dependent on external funding for science equipment. And we're in a situation in this country where middle-class communities have the ability to support activities in schools, which will improve the life chances of the pupils there to a level that deprived communities would struggle to match. And the Scottish Government should aim to level that playing field for all schools by supporting increased funding for science equipment. Yep, certainly.
Minister.
Thank you very, very much. Can I just make the point that you raised some very interesting points about lab technicians and equipment, which is obviously a matter for local authorities. But the school that I went to didn't need expensive equipment. The kaleidoscopes were made from Pringle tubes. Other tubes are available if people want to make other kaleidoscopes. But the point is they are made because of innovative teaching. And that's what I said in my speech, that we are supporting through CEREC and through other. It's about innovative and experimental teaching and using everyday objects to actually explore science in the real world. So yes, expenditure is one item, but we are investing in the teachers for everyone to be able to do that.
Mr. Griffith, I'll give you some time back, because that was quite a long intervention.
Thank you, President. So I take the point that teachers can employ innovative measures, but for complex science equipment, I think we're going to need a bit more than a Pringles tube. But I do accept that there are examples where that can be used, but there is such a big disparity. 80% more spent in England than there is in Scotland. Practical science equipment, I think, will have an impact on pupils in Scotland. But I also had spoken about inequality, and I've mentioned before in the chamber that I studied mechanical engineering at university, and that one of the key source of skills and graduates for a lot of the sectors that are growing in Scotland provides fantastic opportunities for highly skilled, highly paid work. And there were 120 students on my course. Out of 124, four in that course were women. And that's even before you look at the issue of female STEM graduates actually leaving the profession and going on to employment in other fields. And I think how this government opens up careers in science and technology to half the population will determine how successful they are at tackling the issue of inequality within STEM. We've heard from other speakers mentioning Equate Scotland. They've made recommendations on tackling the problem around recruiting more female STEM teachers so there's no visible gender difference, making sure guidance teachers and school careers advisors are trained in guiding students to embrace what they're good at, not encouraging or discouraging a subject due to their sex. And there's work done to stop the bias in guidance in schools where girls are guided towards biology. And it would be interesting to hear the government response to those Equate Scotland suggestions. But, Presiding Officer, I see I'm running out of time. Clearly, there are big challenges with falling teacher numbers, falling science support staff, shortfalls in funding for equipment. But there is a big prize at the end of the day. There's 7 million highly paid science jobs that we can aim for and that we can achieve.
Thank you very much. I call Stuart Stevenson to follow by Tabby Scott. Mr. Stevenson, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. You asked about blockchain. It would take rather longer than 5 minutes, but I'll just say the one commercial product you may be familiar with that uses the technology is the electronic currency called Bitcoin. Depends on blockchain. So I leave that with you, Presiding Officer, for later. Ross Thompson, unfortunately he can read it later. Ross Thompson said the Scots invented the steam engine. Probably not. It was a guy called Hero, who is a Greek philosopher and thinker who invented the steam turbine in 100 AD. And it's actually thought that he was only building on the ideas that were 200 years before that. So we Scots invented most things, but we can concede one or two others. Richard Feynman has been mentioned. Terrific guy. He, a terrific communicator and teacher, who, as a member of the Challenger Space Shuttle Commission looking into the disaster, he was gagged, not allowed to speak, and at the press conference was able to show up what had happened without saying a single word. I've said it before, go and read some of my old speeches. But I think the key thing, perhaps, I want to pick up just briefly, is the role of gender. When I started in computers in the 1960s, the interesting thing was about 50% of those who worked in programming at that time were female. And of course, the reason was working in computers was an unknown profession. It wasn't sexy. It wasn't what was drawing people to things. And furthermore, the great heroes of computing are largely female. Ada Lovelace, who was the only legitimate child of Lord Byron, was Charles Babbage's computer programmer with the analytical machine, which was a mechanical computer. But she developed the first algorithm, recognizing the way that we develop computer programs today. And of course, Rear Admiral Grace Hopper was the person who created the way we now develop computer programs, particularly using the language COBOL, and she's responsible for the term computer bug, when a bug, American word for a moth, got trapped in the electromechanical contacts of a computer run. And if you go to the Smithsonian, you can actually see the bug sellotaped in the lab page in 1944 by Grace Hopper. So sex and the differentiation between male and female engagement in computing is a comparatively modern thing, and I've no explanation for why that has actually happened. What I do want to talk about, Presiding Officer, is education, but not in the way that it's been talked about now. I, for my part, am an autodidact. That means the gaps in my knowledge are entirely my own fault, nobody else's. I did have inspirational teachers, Doc Ingalls, who was a bluff Lancastrian, first year class at school, took us round the school searching for infinity.
We looked in the dustbins, we looked behind the blackboards. But the point is, I remember it to this day. That's what inspiring teachers do. And in sixth year, he came and did his tax return with us, either to show us what little amount of money he got paid for putting up with us, or to show us there was a practical application for being numerate. Now, people say they're uncomfortable in numbers. And whenever people say that to them and say, do you think you could give me an 11-digit number? And they say, oh, no, certainly not, certainly not. And they say, well, here's a number. Does it mean anything to you? 01313485000. And people in this place hopefully say, oh, yes, I know that's the Parliament, the switchboard in the Parliament. So everybody has basically got ability to engage with numbers, but it's subconscious and they don't actually realise it. I think the key thing we perhaps are omitting in the strategy is making sure that parents and families are able to create a number-friendly environment at the very outset of children's lives. That makes a difference to the attitudes they will have at a later stage in their life. And there are little games we can play with science. My four-year-old goddaughter, we dissolved salt crystals because she'd seen a rock crystal and she said, what's a crystal? I said, well, here's a crystal. We dissolved it in water, then we put it in a pan, boiled it off and got the salt back. And she went away and briefed her nursery class about this piece of science. When she next comes to see me, we're going to do a couple of things. We're going to use a mixture of alum and vinegar to write a message on the white of a hard-boiled egg through the shell. You only can read the message when you peel the shell off, and we'll discuss why that matters. And of course, because young children are always somewhat scatological, we will use human urine to write on a piece of paper a message. It disappears and then reappears when you heat the bit of paper, you can see the message. So there are lots of things we can engage kids with that will make a real difference to their attitude, to numbers, to science, equip them with a questioning mind. Because at the end of the day, I'm not bothered about what knowledge anybody has. If you've got a questioning mind, you're going to get the knowledge for yourself, the knowledge that matters to you, and that's ultimately what will make you successful in life. All this business about supporting the economy and so on, entirely secondary. I want to see successful, happy, and engaged people in STEM subjects. And I think if we individually, as parents and families, help, we'll make substantial progress. And I hope that's ultimately reflected in the strategy we end up with, Presiding Officer.
I was loath to stop you, Mr. Stevenson, in your journey through quaint scientific experiments. I'll need to read your speech later. Tavish Scott, you're followed by Stuart McMillan. Mr. Scott, follow that.
Well, please. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's always a great pleasure to follow Mr. Stevenson. I think I heard him earlier on in his earlier remarks saying that he goes back and reads his old speeches. Well, that speech will be worthy of reading many times from many different perspectives. And there were so many references to so many different things in it that I'm just not going to mention them. Instead, because I'd be defeated by them all, I thought I'd start by some evidence that was given to the Education Committee in Parliament yesterday when we were considering the future of Skills Development Scotland as part of the budget considerations. And in their evidence, the CBI said in relation to STEM, in the relation to teaching science, technology, engineering and mathematics, that most young people attribute their decision to pursuing these subjects to an inspirational teacher. And that does appear to me to be a good place to start in this subject. It's why the CBI, and indeed others, I mean, there was much mention of Sir Ian Wood's work in this broad area, but indeed others see their role in providing that assistance. And I have to confess that I think it's not just about inspirational teachers, and there has been much statistical analysis of the number of teachers, but it is also about who your parents are and what your parents do as well. I know plenty of young men of my son's age at home in Shetland who are engineers because dad is either in an engineering business or works in the oil industry or has that and has had that influence on those lives. So there is a role, yes, of course, for schools and for teachers and for all that they can be in encouraging the next generation, both as Alison Johnson rightly mentioned girls as well as boys, because the statistics certainly on girls being science professionals or IT professionals or indeed engineers are pretty woeful at the moment. But on that, it is also about how many are influenced by the family around them. Now, there appears to me some very strong work done that illustrates that the sooner and the earlier in school the teaching of science can happen, the better. Now, I actually take the Cabinet Secretary's point in terms of the pressures in primary schools. It wasn't that long ago that we were being told as parents, and indeed, therefore, the profession, that two languages at primary school level was the overriding priority. I went to my primary school son's parents' night the other night, and in the 10-minute slot that I and his mum got to consider how his schooling was going, we had 9 minutes on numeracy and literacy, and that was it, until I asked, how's he actually doing? And I have concerns as a parent, I must confess, about a complete push on just two areas, which, yes, are of course important, but we also need to remember at primary school, it's also about kids just growing up and becoming little social characters that are in their own right. And therefore, I do take the wider point that the Cabinet Secretary has been making, and indeed others have implicitly recognised this, about the pressures that we're already putting primary school teachers under, and how science, admirable as the teaching of science at an early enough level can be, fits into that. Also, I do not think we can have this debate without being in some ways vaguely consistent about the concerns that we have all expressed about the workload on teachers, both at primary and at secondary school level. I was quizzing the Cabinet Secretary, I don't think he was wholly thanking me for this the other day, but quizzing him on the benchmarks the government have just issued across the network, across schools, both at primary and secondary level. And my observation, and it's been given to me by many teaching professionals, is Education Scotland would need to reduce the E's and O's at the same time as introducing the benchmarks. In other words, could there be some reduction in teacher workload and paperwork, as well as these benchmarks, which I have also been told are sensible and a constructive way forward. Now, if we load science onto all of that as well, I think we do at least need to recognise the impact that does have both on primary and secondary schools. And in that, on secondary schools, I just want to make two points. The first is, again, I can't be the only parent who knows that his son cannot do three science subjects at fifth year. The school timetable now under Curriculum for Excellence, certainly in most schools I've been made aware of, just does not facilitate that because of the narrowing of choice that we've had. So again, I don't think we can see these issues in isolation. I think we at least need to be alive to the fact that while we aspire through the strategy, which I welcome too, as Ian Gray rightly mentioned, while we aspire to encourage more to undertake STEM subjects, at the same time, with the reality of Curriculum for Excellence is that we are reducing the ability of schools to provide that choice and to provide certainly three sciences in the way in which, when, dare I say it, many moons ago when I went to school, not that I did three sciences, you could certainly do. And let me just finish, Presiding Officer, with the observation about that others have made about the Cabinet Secretary's remarks yesterday. I thought he was commendably fair about the challenges, as Ian Gray, I think, rightly mentioned. I think all the opposition's doing today is saying these challenges have been around some time. We've all been in this Parliament for some considerable period of time. And as Liz Smith said, these are challenges we want the strategy to deliver on. I think Parliament's just encouraging the government to do that today.
Thank you. I have no spare time now, so it's a tight 5 minutes for the speakers from now on. Stuart McMillan to be followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Certainly it's been an interesting and an informative debate, and I always enjoy the contributions from my colleague Stuart Stevenson, because I know I'm always going to learn at least one or two things. But there's two points I just want to touch upon, certainly from Stuart Stevenson's contribution, also Ross Thompson's. Certainly in terms of Ross Thompson, when he spoke about the opportunities, I want to gently make Ross Thompson aware that certainly within the heavy engineering sector and also shipbuilding, within the last 4 years, Ferguson Shipbuilders in Port Glasgow hired its first ever female technical apprentice. Think about that. It took up to the last 4 years before the first ever shipbuilding technical apprentice took place in a shipyard on the Clyde. Now, so there haven't always been opportunities for females in terms of science, technology, engineering, and the mathematical areas. And certainly the same point goes to regarding my colleague Stuart Stevenson. But Mr. Stevenson highlighted the computing sector with a 50% in the past, but the shipbuilding and heavy engineering, certainly those opportunities weren't always there. But I do welcome the STEM consultation and also the four key priorities of excellence, equality, inspiration and also connection. And as we have already heard today, progress has been made, but there is still more to do. And that's, you can say that for, with every single walk of life. There's always still more that people can do. There has been the 3% increase in girls entering science qualifications, including computing, since 2007. Girls passing higher chemistry and higher physics is up by 8% and 10% respectively. There is a 62% increase in passes in human biology by girls, which helps explain the 16.9% decrease in biology. But also, Presiding Officer, in 2014-15, there were 27% more female full-time equivalent science and maths students and 55% more full-time equivalent engineering students in colleges compared to 2006-07. Now, these figures are positive and certainly should be welcomed by all, but as I've stated, we can always do more. The increases in college students is something that I believe to be hugely important. Now, on Monday, I attended the local Inverclyde Alliance Community Planning Partnership meeting, and we heard a hugely informative presentation from the principal of West College Scotland, Audrey Cumberford. Now, part of the presentation centred around the college's refocused drive regarding STEM subjects. There is an increase in demand at local level for people with STEM qualifications, and Ferguson Marine and Port Glasgow have taken on an ambitious and welcome apprenticeship programme. And they have a link with the college to help deliver this. And there are now more female apprentices as a result of this. But in order to satisfy our economic challenges, the consultation is welcome, but I also believe every MSP has a role to play. If not already doing so, we should be promoting STEM subjects when we talk to our constituents, whether they're young or older. And I would urge all members to promote the consultation. And I have written to every school in my constituency to make them aware of the consultation, and I've asked the head teachers to actually pass the information on to students, the teachers, and also parents. And I want to touch upon one other point, Presiding Officer, and that was raised during today's First Minister's questions. Now, Murdo Fraser uttered the phrase of Scottish shambles. Now, notwithstanding the downplaying and talking down of our nation, I'm sure members, and hopefully Mr. Fraser included, will agree with me that, that the many examples of shambolic projects taking place elsewhere, and I'll explain why I'm touching upon this, Presiding Officer. Hinkley Point C, the initial cost estimate was $14 billion, it's now up to $37 billion. HS2, the continual increase in cost, is now up to some $55.7 billion. And the cost per kilometre is 10 times the price, well, more as compared to other global counterparts. And also Trident, the continual increase in price, and that's reported to be now some £205 billion lifetime costs. And also the refurbishment of the Westminster Parliament. Deloitte estimate costs between £3 billion and £4.3 billion, but higher figures have been highlighted by others. Now, I raise these points, Presiding Officer, to highlight two issues. First of all, as well as STEM challenges, to deal with these huge projects, I would encourage the UK government to actually get some accountants involved to actually limit the exorbitant increases if these projects actually do go ahead. But also, before Mr. Fraser talks down Scotland, he should consider the actions and the mathematical illiteracy of his colleagues and his political masters in London. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. McMillan. Jamie Green, to be followed by Willie Coffey. Mr. Green, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. First of all, I'd like to thank Jenny Goruff for putting some doubts in my head. And those doubts are whether D equals S over T or T equals D over S. I always got that triangle wrong at school, but I'm going to go away and research it after this. This debate is quite important today, and I think there have been some interesting contributions actually from across the chamber. Scotland is really a nation that encompasses a strong global reputation for its excellence in STEM subjects. And I think it's through the talent and entrepreneurial spirit of Scottish people that we've built the great nation that we are today. The importance of STEM subjects is that these subjects cover such a far-reaching spectrum of industries and job opportunities, which I think are so crucial to the future success of the Scottish economy. Now, as our economy modernises, I think it's our duty to ensure that the Scots of tomorrow are given the opportunity to play their part in that economy. I'd like to take one example, it's close to my heart, it's the digital economy. In that sector, there is huge growth, but with that growth comes a huge demand for programmers, engineers, and software developers to keep up with that demand. Now, we know that every year there are 11,000 digital vacancies in Scotland, but we're only ever able to fill around half of those. So if we're struggling to meet the industry's demands of today, it's going to be even more challenging, surely, to keep up with the demands of tomorrow. Therefore, the need to train people to keep up with tomorrow's demands is never more paramount. But this is a problem not just in the digital industry. I think we're seeing a worrying trend that exposes how underprepared our workforce is to adapt to changes in the market in the future. An example being, in a recent survey by Pearson and the CBI, it underlined that Scotland is simply not producing enough STEM graduates to keep up with the demands of the modern Scottish market. A separate survey by the CBI found that 42% of STEM recruits are falling short in their employers' expectations of skills. Now, I think Stuart McMillan made some valid points, actually. One of the points being that it is our duty to be ambassadors for this subject matter. I was interested to hear experiences from members on what inspired them in sciences. I think we all have a personal story that we have of something that we saw on television or something we did at school or someone who nurtured us in our interest in the sciences or technology. And I think that's a really important point in that we can talk about statistics and rises and falls and trends, but actually it's about inspiring young people to get involved in sciences. And I think whilst the consultation mentioned some great projects, I think there is still much more we could do as MSPs. Analysis in the US, for example, shows that 40% of American STEM graduates do not actually work in a direct field that's related to what they studied. So, in other words, graduating from a STEM field, I think, offers graduates much greater flexibility in their career choices. Now, this debate is important in Scotland because we know that physics-based sectors account for over £12.5 billion of the Scottish economic output. We estimate more than 180,000 people are directly employed in these sectors. And many sectors that the Scottish economy is so reliant on for its future success, such as oil and gas, agriculture, energy and renewables, is so reliant on STEM graduates. It was only last week I stood in this very spot and talked about digital participation. But 17% of Scottish schools lack a specialist IT teacher. So how can we expect our young to succeed in the digital world of tomorrow if we aren't providing them enough teachers today? It's even more worrying, as other members have alluded to, that there is a disparity in female students in these subjects. Less than a third of physics higher students are women, and Skills Development Scotland themselves point out that only 13% of STEM jobs are occupied by females. Now, in my own region, it's great to see that Ayrshire College has recognised this problem and in response has put together some very specific programmes to address this. This Ayrshire Girl Can tag is, I hope, very successful, but I'd like that to be this Scottish Girl Can. I'd like to see that extended. In closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, my colleague Liz Smith rightfully pointed out, as did Tavish Scott, that this debate has happened before. There's a bit of groundhog in this chamber today. I think the government's agenda has been complacent to date, and I hope the Scottish Government listens intently to what's been said across this chamber from all parties and puts more immediate focus on STEM. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Green. And on the issue of the groundhog, how far did it travel? D equals S times T. I thought I'd put you out of your misery. Can I call Willie Coffey to be followed by Sandra White? Mr. Coffey, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Somewhere, something incredible is waiting to be known. Those were the words of astronomer Professor Carl Sagan, who inspired a generation, young and old, to love science and all that it could do for mankind. A brilliant communicator who was behind the Pioneer plaque and golden record in the Voyager project in 1977, which took the first messages from Earth into space. Since he died in 1998, some pretty incredible things are now known. We know the universe is accelerating as it expands when we thought it was slowing down. We know something about dark energy and dark matter and how they make that happen. We've discovered the Higgs boson particle that is thought to be responsible for all the mass in the universe. Traces of water have been found in the moon and in Mars, and only this year, a potentially habitable planet has been discovered about 4 light years away from Earth. Today, we have Professor Brian Cox, a truly inspiring physicist whose fantastic TV programmes are capturing the minds of countless numbers of youngsters today to be hooked on science. Presiding Officer, inspiring our young people is the key that opens the door to more incredible discoveries and underpins the success of the strategies and systems we put in place to enable it all to happen. This STEM strategy has just been published for consultation, I think, builds on achievements to date, gathers much of the work already underway together in one place, and seeks views on how we might solve the many issues we still face and that have been recognised by members in the Chamber. It talks about enthusing and inspiring our young people, asking them what they think, offering more training and skills, reaching out to females and making those vital connections with colleges, universities and employers that can be the basis for a wonderful career in STEM. All positive and with an emphasis on how we might overcome some of those problems that we face. Money, of course, helps, and I'm pleased to see substantial investments being made to upskill primary and secondary science teachers and technicians, local authority champions, and practical support too for science teachers. On top of that, a further significant investment of £12 million has been targeted at retraining some of our oil and gas workers to become STEM teachers. I particularly like the digital schools programme idea to try out digital skills development in schools, and I commend East Ayrshire Council's initiative that has made iPads available to every pupil and teacher in a number of schools to help encourage learning no matter where the pupils may be. Presiding Officer, for me, a crucial intervention that must take place is to try and retain the enthusiasm that primary school children have for science, but all too often they lose as soon as they get to secondary school, and particularly girls. To complement our strategy, there are a number of ideas I'd like to suggest that we consider further. Perhaps we should establish more school science clubs and have Young Scientists of the Year awards with prizes and recognition events that overlap with late primary and the early secondary years. Maybe we should encourage science lectures in our primary and secondary schools with practicing scientists, telling our young people about their work using demonstrations and multimedia. Could we also have national science recognition and achievement awards in Scotland, similar to the scheme that President Obama introduced in 2008, just after he was first elected, and which will hopefully not be abolished by President Trump? Could we identify youngsters with particular aptitudes in science and see how we can nurture that so that they don't disconnect from it as they move to secondary school? We could also, I think, do with more dedicated science TV channels that are broadcasting at the right times of the day and aimed at youngsters and adults too. Hopefully some of these ideas might be taken up or see the light of day if we're to make Scotland a special place for science and technology. Presiding Officer, Scotland has a wonderful history of achievement in science that we should all be proud of. These strategies and systems we devise certainly need to be correct, but they'll only work if we enthuse and excite the next generation of young scientists here to make these incredible discoveries that are unknown to us at this moment. I'm absolutely certain that we have the youngsters in Scotland right now who will make these incredible discoveries if we excite them enough about science and make it possible for them to achieve great things. Somewhere in Scotland, something incredible is waiting to be known by our young scientists to be. So let's back the strategy, excite and encourage our youngsters to embrace science and watch the next generation of incredible discoveries unfolding here in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Call Sandra White, who's the last speaker in the open debate. Thank you, Ms. White.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Certainly has some very interesting and knowledgeable speeches, certainly more knowledgeable than I could ever give, and I don't just mean Mr. Stevenson, and certain other ones as well. But I do very much welcome being given the opportunity to discuss, which I feel is very important, science, technology, engineering and mathematics, particularly today as we celebrate World Science Day. Presiding Officer, Scotland has a very strong reputation in the subjects which I've just mentioned, but we must continue to build on that reputation that we have. We really must have a strong foundation in place for those who want to follow a career in STEM, and I do think we're going forward in the right way about it. I just want to basically highlight a number of organisations which I have actually had here in the Parliament and have visited as well in regards to how they've actually enthused me and others into how science, particularly and mathematics and all the other issues that we raised today, can be not just career-wise, but can be really exciting as well in that respect. Now, the three organisations I did want to mention are FEME in Rwanda, Glasgow Science Centre and Kidney Research UK. Now, these are all organisations I've hosted in the Parliament and had events in the Parliament. And last night, I hosted Kidney Research UK, which pioneers renal research. Now, £9.5 million come to Scotland through this research. And throughout all the contributions, the one thing that they all said was that the reason that this investment was being in Scotland was because Scotland had excellent universities. Indeed, they had excellent scientists and research facilities as well. Indeed, the actual report mentions the representation of Scotland scientists, clinicians and kidney patients has been vital to two of the biggest research UK initiatives. So I think that tells you something about just how well Scotland does in that particular field. Now, the FEMN one I was talking about was actually a student network established in 2013 by Ellen Simmons, a biomedical engineering student at the University of Glasgow. And FEMN students have been running programmes and activities and workshops. Take them out to schools promoting science and engineering, and that's what I was trying to say. It's perhaps a new revolutionary way of doing it, but it's something that the young people are very, very interested in. And they went over to Rwanda and put forward an innovative scientific programme with female students from Rwanda, and this was led by Glasgow University engineering and science students. Absolutely fantastic. 500 Rwandan schoolgirls were actually became team members, and that encouraged them to take up further subjects in science and engineering. So that's something which is being led by Glasgow University and engineering students also. And it's really a unique and progressive way of learning, and it involved everyone, groups of young women in Rwanda and also the students from Glasgow University, and give them the opportunity that science can offer. And I hope that will be able to continue. Now, some members may have seen the Bodyworks on Tour project, which was here in the Parliament, created by Glasgow Science Centre. That was just this week as well, and it was on display in the Parliament. Now, it was really full of interactive and, most importantly, educational workstations, which has been touring schools throughout the country. And it really inspired children and kids to be interactive with exhibits that were there. And it actually taught them about their health, their body, well-being. And it took science out into the masses of school children from primary school onwards. I thoroughly enjoyed it, I must admit, and it certainly gave me another insight into how mathematics, stem cells, etc., all went together, and it was really absolutely amazing. Now, Glasgow Science Centre has embraced the challenge of getting our kids excited and interested in science. They've an extensive, as I said to Ian Gray, an extensive education programme which is linked to the curriculum of excellence, as well as a large collection of resources for teachers to access and use in the classrooms. Now, that's something we should be aspiring to all over, and I really congratulate the Science Centre in Glasgow for doing that. And just this week, to mark World Science Centre Day, school children attended the centre and they planted a tree using the pips from an apple tree, which obviously inspired Sir Isaac Newton's theories about gravity. And the Science Centre presented it in such a way that young kids absolutely thoroughly enjoyed it, and that's where we've got to go forward. Yeah, I'm in my last couple of seconds. I just want to say the projects that I've mentioned, I think, encapsulates the key priorities mentioned in the motion from the Scottish Government: excellence, equality, inspiration and connection. And I really do look forward to further projects coming forward from there. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. White. I now call Daniel Johnson to close for Labour. Mr. Johnson, 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We've had much discussion in this Parliament about STEM, and with good reason. Science, technology, engineering, maths are the foundations of our future country and the future economy. We've had discussions about enterprise agencies, innovation, modern apprenticeships, and if we are to embrace the changes that our economy is facing, STEM is critical. And indeed, I think both Mark Griffin and Jamie Green have done a very good job this afternoon laying the context of that. Mark Griffin outlined that by 2030 there will be 7 million jobs in the UK dependent on science. And likewise, I think Jamie Green did an excellent job highlighting that both the opportunities but also the challenges that the digital economy bring. But I think as much as STEM is important for new jobs, it's also important for doing old jobs in new ways. As much as we will have geneticists using robots in order to carry out their genetics works, we'll also, if you talk to builders, they're only too aware that technology is coming their way too, that 3D printing technologies, off-site prefabrication. Every single one of our jobs will be touched by technology, from doctors to teachers to shopkeepers to civil servants, chefs, maybe even politicians. We will all need to understand how to use science and technology to do our daily jobs. And I think as we look at this debate, it is very important, if we're going to embrace these changes, that we have to understand the status quo. We have to understand where we are so that we can make a plan. Now, I know that the minister was a little unwilling to go straight into stats, so let me talk about experience. An experience of a physics teacher from my constituency who came to me to talk about the challenges of teaching National 4 and National 5 together. So both parts of both of those curriculums is the teaching of waves. But the problem is, you have to teach in a single class the concept of sound waves for National 4 along with electromagnetic waves for National 5. That simply is deeply challenging, meaning that either one of those is going to be done in an unsatisfying way. But further to that, she was saying that their resource budget is stretched by buying stop clocks, new stop clocks for the labs. Now, you might be able to teach English with tatty books, but science needs resources. And as Mark Griffin again pointed out, the resourcing in Scotland is just lagged behind that of the rest of the UK, with £7.33 being spent per pupil in Scotland compared to £10.12 in the rest in England. Now, I almost wanted to laugh when Shirley-Ann Somerville brought up Pringles tubes as a serious alternative to spending in classrooms. But frankly, science needs resource, it needs support. And when you couple suggestions of that with the fact that we are losing two science teachers per week since 2007 in Scotland, that our technicians have been cut by a quarter, that lab assistants have been cut by half by 2007, you understand that the very serious situation that we face in our science laboratories and our schools. We need support, we need resource, and we need a curriculum that works. Now, I agree with the Scottish Government with much of what they say in the strategy. A strategy is important, it's urgent. But the reality is, the question is, what are they doing? And we need more teachers, but all that we have in the strategy is discussion of a pipeline. Now, Presiding Officer, I used to be a management consultant and I can smell management jargon when it's put in front of me. You talk about a pipeline when you don't want to talk about the complexities of the challenges of what you have to deliver. Simply talking about the pipeline, imagining it's as simple as bolting something together and turning on tap is not good enough. The reality is we only have a trickle of teachers coming through. We're barely replacing teachers exiting the profession. So what we need is a strategy, but what we have is a consultation. And I think Ian Gray was right to point out that a strategy needs a plan. It needs resources behind it, and we need a plan with a specific timetable because there is urgency. Because again, I think Liz Smith was absolutely right to point out that this is not a new set of challenges. You know, this is not a new government. This is a government that has 10 years to deal with these issues. But again, time after time in this parliament we've come back, we have consultation after consultation. But these challenges are not new. We need action now. And indeed, I think that the paucity of this plan comes under real scrutiny when you look at gender. And I think Jenny Gilruth and Ross Thompson were absolutely right to raise the challenges of gender. But in this plan, all we have is essentially a kind of warm words for what is already happening, vague promises of funding for external organisations, and support for already existing work. It's quite simply is not good enough. It doesn't deal with the underlying challenges or the underlying issues that need to be dealt with.
Thank you. You must conclude. It's a good place to stop. No, you must conclude. You've done your 5 minutes. Thank you very much. You have 7 minutes, Mr. Mountain, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was rather nervous when I was asked to speak in this debate this afternoon, remembering what I was always told at school, that I could have done better. but it appears that I'm in good company this afternoon and we could all do better. We've heard in today's debate there is agreement across the chamber that STEM subjects provide a broad spectrum of valuable and versatile skills, from analysing to problem solving. And these skills are vitally important as pupils not only progress through school, further education, higher education, apprenticeships, and then on to their chosen careers. What we've heard is also that one of the serious issues that we need to address and should cause us all concern is the low level of representation of girls taking up STEM subjects at secondary school. And consequently, the fall in the number of girls in STEM subjects at higher level. High level maths down by 2%, in physics down by 7%, and in biology down by 21%. Not enough is being done across the chamber to encourage girls to take up these vitally important subjects, subjects which are becoming increasingly attractive and sought after in this technologically advancing economy. Now, the government cannot claim that they have progressed this if they accept, as the figures show, that STEM teacher numbers have fallen. As my colleague Liz Smith and indeed Daniel Johnson have said in their speeches, there's a major problem with recruitment of teachers. Since 2007, we've seen more than 100 STEM teachers cut every single year. That's 410 fewer maths teachers, 187 fewer computing teachers, 105 fewer chemistry teachers. We need these teachers to be replaced, and I agree with Tavish Scott, and indeed with Stuart Stevenson, that these teachers need to be inspirational to encourage people into the subjects. Now, if the government's going to seize upon these opportunities and the possibilities that STEM subjects can offer, surely that they will accept that a strong foundation can only be built on if these numbers of teachers are present. Now, Ross Thompson, in a nutshell, made it clear that if we don't encourage girls to have an active interest in STEM subjects at a young age, and by that I mean primary school age, there's less chance of encouraging these girls to have an interest in STEM subjects at further and higher education. Now, when I was looking at the figures, it appeared that female students that graduate in STEM subjects, the vast majority, that's 73%, don't go on to a STEM occupation. That's quite frankly not good enough. And surely we must all accept that huge, huge improvements need to be made there. Now, it also, I think, falls on the government, who rightly, in my mind, champion gender equality, to accept that they need to work on this, and that in the last few years, in fact, the last 7 years, they failed to do so. Now, can I turn to the role which the UK businesses can play in relation to STEM? As Jamie Green mentioned in his speech about apprenticeships, I think that we need to do more work here. Now, the UK government has announced in 2015 they were introducing an apprenticeship levy, and this could possibly fund up to 3 million apprenticeships. I believe that we need to ensure that some of these apprenticeships are STEM apprenticeships, so we can encourage people into that area. Now, I don't have sufficient time to go into major detail on examples of these, but I'm going to give you two examples which I believe do work, and that's Tech Future for Girls by Hewlett Packard Enterprise and Apps for Good. Really good examples of industries that are encouraging apprenticeships. And I believe the Scottish Government needs to step up to the mark and do more work to encourage businesses to grow apprenticeships. Now, before I conclude, Presiding Officer, I thought it'd be interesting to highlight two countries and what two countries are doing in this field. Firstly, in Germany, the Federal Ministry of Education and Research has developed a long-term strategic partnership between science and business. They have launched two initiatives to further the aim: leading edge cluster competition and public-private partnerships to foster innovation. Important components of these initiatives include collaborative research and development and developing innovative academic training and degree programs. Now, the German federal government promotes these systems of vocational education as a key factor in maintaining youth unemployment, And the fact that they maintain that youth unemployment at 8.2%, the lowest in Europe, must make this worthy of consideration. The second is in the Netherlands, where the government has, in education sectors, commissioned Beta Technic. Now, I'm acutely aware that I could run out of time, so I'm not going to explain that all, but if the government would like further information on that, I'm quite happy to give them that. But it's clear to me it takes a holistic approach to solve the problem. We need to make scientific careers more attractive to young people whilst being innovative in the field of education to ensure we engage young people at the earliest possible age. We should target industry, schools and university, policymakers, and specific regional and economic sectors to help us with this. And we need to specifically target girls and women and also ethnic minorities. Now, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, Scotland has had an excellent reputation over the centuries for performing and being world leaders in STEM subjects. Ross Thompson has said, we've proved ourselves as being entrepreneurial and an innovative centre for Europe. Discovery of antibiotics, tropical medicine, the invention of the steam engine and television. It's from that history that we need to recognise the great achievements in science and to build on them. We must channel this success into promoting STEM and education in the future. It is with great sadness, therefore, to me, that the SEAG secondary report, which was published in 2012, indicated that the government hasn't taken positive action on 63 of the recommendations. That, to me, is more than disappointing. To me, they've let themselves down. They've let Scotland down. And perhaps we should concentrate more on our future and what we can do for our children than harping about what has gone on in the past. Thank you,
Mr. Mountain. I call on Mr. Swinney to close for the government, Cabinet Secretary, till 5 o'clock, please.
Presiding Officer, I just point out to Mr. Mountain that he's just concluded his speech by the need to focus on the future and not harp on about the past, and just delivered a speech in which he harped on about the past. So it's just an interesting contradiction in the line of argument from the Conservatives. The highlight of this debate this afternoon for me, Presiding Officer, was undoubtedly the speech by Stuart Stevenson. I think I speak for all members in that connection, because I don't think it takes much imagination to conceive of Mr. Stevenson as a school pupil searching for infinity in his classroom. It is quite an endearing picture for us all to contemplate, but not a picture that really takes us much to imagine the possibility of Mr. Stevenson engaging in that with such energy and enthusiasm. And I want to, first of all, set out the government's purpose in taking forward the STEM strategy and the consultation that has been the subject of debate this afternoon. This has been led by the Science Minister, Shirley Ann Somerville. It's been significantly informed by the contribution of our Chief Scientific Advisor, Professor Sheila Rowan. And it's important that those entrusted with taking forward the science agenda within the government are given our support in advancing what's an important subject. But it's not lost on me that the leadership of our agenda on science is entrusted to our Science Minister and our Chief Scientific Advisor, both of whom are women. And it's indicative of the government's determination to tackle the issue of the gender imbalance in the pursuit of science within our country. Now, the government acknowledges that there is much more that needs to be done to advance all of these arguments. And there is, on many points, we'll disagree this afternoon, but I think it is very clear that on the question of strengthening the relationship between the gender imbalance and STEM and increasing participation in STEM is something upon which we are all agreed. So I'm very happy to confirm to Parliament today that the government will in a very focused way look at the aims of the strategy to ensure that the fundamental issue of addressing the issue of gender imbalance is at the heart of all that we do in taking forward the next steps of this strategy. Yes, I will do.
Mr. Green.
I thank John Swinney for taking this intervention. If the government is so committed to improving the amount of females in studying in Scotland, then why has there been a 41% decrease in the amount of women in college in Scotland in 8 years?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, actually, the level of female participation in full-time equivalent places in colleges is on the increase, and the data will show that. And that is because the government is concentrated on college places that will support the journey into work for individuals, which is the purpose of college education. Now, a number of colleagues across the political spectrum have paid tribute to my candour at the Royal Society of Chemistry yesterday, and I appreciate that. Because the government goes into this debate with the determination of ensuring that we strengthen the delivery of STEM within Scotland and that we maximise the effectiveness of that. And of course the government should be challenged on these questions. But it's also equally valid that the opposition look carefully at what it is they are being asked to vote for in the opposition amendments today. And I want to spend a little bit of time just going through these amendments. On the Conservative amendment, the first part of it laments the fact there's been no response from the government to the call for fully trained science teachers in primary schools. Despite the fact that I answered this question myself, and I've only been in office for a few months, at the Royal Society of Chemistry event yesterday, and also because the opposition know full well that the Curriculum for Excellence is founded on the principle of our primary school teachers being generalist teachers who are supported to deliver the education that young people require, which is why the government invests in the Scottish Schools Education Research Centre to upskill primary and secondary teachers and technicians to make that contribution. I'll give way to
Liz Smith.
The Cabinet Secretary accept that the calls that are being made from the learned societies and from the groups who are specialists in physics and chemistry and biology, etc., they're making the very point that they want these specialisms because they feel that the evidence, which has been alluded to in many speeches that have been made this afternoon, that we have a severe problem within the STEM area, which is not providing or not delivering on the goods that the Scottish Government itself set out in 2012.
Cabinet Secretary.
We won't always be able to do what all the learned societies want us to do, because what Curriculum for Excellence is based on is the delivery of a broad general education. Mr. Scott made that point in what I thought was a very thoughtful contribution to the debate. And the point that I made to Liz Smith in my earlier intervention is one that she cannot dodge. She comes into this chamber on a regular basis, demanding that we focus on literacy and numeracy, and then comes into the chamber today and demands that we focus on science. No, I've given way, I've got more ground to cover. So the contradiction at the heart of the Conservative position is laid bare on this question. But the contradiction goes further. In the second part of Liz Smith's amendment, she laments the fact that there has been no reversal to the recent and damaging cuts to the number of Scottish secondary school teachers in key STEM subjects. Now, again, this gets to the heart of some of the dilemmas at the heart of education. I do not choose, and I have no ability to choose, who are the teachers in individual schools in the country. That is properly the preserve of local authorities. But Liz Smith and others will come here and complain about when I try to ensure that local authorities are able to take forward some of the priorities of the government on teacher numbers, which is what I've put money into the financial settlement to enable that to be the case. And of course I'll give way to Liz Smith.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving away. This is not the Conservatives that are making these points. This is the teaching profession. Absolutely. It's the colleges and the universities and businesses. Will he not accept that?
Well, I don't know how it's not the Conservatives making these points, because it's in the Conservative amendment that members of Parliament have been asked to vote about. But my point to Liz Smith is that she's at the front of the queue trying to protect the rights of local authorities to take decisions on education, and the burden of her amendment is that somehow I should be telling local authorities how many science teachers they should have in their schools. Now, there are the levels of teachers in our schools today higher than they would be if I hadn't put in place constraints on the ability of local authorities to reduce teacher numbers, which is what they wanted to do. And the teacher numbers are in Scotland at the level that we're at because we put the money in to make sure that was the case. I'll give way to Mr.
Daniel Johnson.
If the Cabinet Secretary wants to talk about constraints, how about the constraint of an 11% fall in local authority budgets? And given that education is one of the largest budget items in local authority budgets, do you not think that somewhat constrains their ability to employ science teachers?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't know what they're applauding. They've been savaging public expenditure from the United Kingdom since 2010. So that, Mr. Johnson, is the explanation of why there are reductions in budgets in Scotland, because of the austerity agenda of the United Kingdom government. Now, let me move on to the next part of the agenda, which is on the points that Ian Gray raises in his amendment, and that's about the levels of participation in these subjects. If we, I'm the first to accept that there are challenges in encouraging young people to become involved in the STEM subjects. But what's at the heart of this strategy is the determination to inspire and to motivate young people to undertake that pursuit, to ensure that they are given the insight and the energy and the enthusiasm to make that contribution. That is at the heart of the government's strategy on STEM. That is what we want to make sure is the case in the classrooms in Scotland. That is what we will focus on in taking forward an agenda which has got ambition about making sure that Scotland is equipped with the STEM potential and capability to meet the economic challenges of the future. And that lies at the heart of the government's agenda today.
That concludes our debate on a STEM strategy. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 2418.1.1 in the name of Ian Gray, which seeks to amend Amendment 2418.1 in the name of Liz Smith, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We shall move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote in Ian Gray's name is yes, 54, no, 61. There were six abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Amendment 2418.1 in the name of Liz Smith, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on a STEM strategy, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 2418.1 in the name of Liz Smith is yes, 54, no, 61. There were six abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The final question is that motion is on motion 2418 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on the Scottish Government's consultation on a strategy for STEM education. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We shall move to a vote again. Members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on the motion in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville is yes, 91, no, 30. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting of Parliament.